Joe. My name's Roy.
Well, come here, Roy, and get groovy. You been uptown?
No, I ain't been uptown, but I've been around.
You mean to say you ain't been uptown?
No, I ain't been uptown. What's uptown?
If it's pleasure you're about, and you feel like stepping out, oh, you've got to shout it, let me off uptown. If it's rhythm that you feel, then it's nothing to conceal, oh, you've got to spill it, let me off uptown. A fella go to top it. If you want to pitch a ball and you can't afford a hall, all you've got to call is let me off uptown.
Anita, oh Anita, say I feel something.
What you feel, Roy? The heat?
No, it must be that uptown rhythm. I feel like blowing.
Well, blow, Roy, blow.
It's my day. Bend an ear and listen to my version
of a really solid Tennessee excursion.
Pardon me, boy, is that the Chattanooga juju?
Yes, yes, track 29.
Boy, you can give me a shine.
Can you afford to board a Chattanooga choo-choo?
I got my fare
and just a trifle to spare.
You leave the Pennsylvania station about a quarter to four. Read a magazine and then you're in Baltimore.
Dinner in the diner, nothing could be finer
than to have your ham and eggs in Carolina.
When you hear the whistle blowing 8 to the bar, then you know that Tennessee is not very far.
Shamalala calling, gotta keep it rolling.
Ooh, ooh, Chattanooga, there you are.
There's gonna be a certain party at the station.
Satin and lace.
I used to call Funny Face. She's gonna cry until I tell her that I'll never roam.
So Chattanooga choo-choo,
won't you choo-choo me home?
Chattanooga, Chattanooga,
get aboard.
Chattanooga, Chattanooga,
all aboard.
Chattanooga, Chattanooga, Chattanooga choo-choo,
won't you choo-choo me home?
Chattanooga choo-choo.
Hello, friends, and welcome to worship on this Pentecost Sunday, the day that we gather together to celebrate the fact that God's Spirit has descended on God's church and has filled us and empowered us to do God's work in the world and to know God's love in all that we do. And how appropriate it is that today we gather to worship not in one centralized building contained and restricted, but scattered throughout our city and our world, sharing God's boundless love in all that we do. And that's what we're here today for, to live into God's call, to joyfully share God's boundless love with all in our community without limitation, exception, or condition. And we are the church, not this building that I'm standing in, but you and me gathered together, committed to that mission. We are the church, the ones that have been called together in love for love. So I welcome you to this space today. My name is Ren Serna. I'm the senior pastor here at University Presbyterian Church, and I am so glad to be able to worship with you today. If you are a guest with us today, I would love to extend a special welcome to you and to get to know you a little bit better. If you're watching live, you can just comment in the comments alongside, just that you're new or that you're visiting. You can fill out a connection card at upcfresno.org/connect, and that'll allow us to reach out to you and to thank you for being here. But however you found yourself with us today, whether it's your first time or your thousandth time, I am so glad that you're here as we seek to know God's love and to share it in all that we do. So please join me in song as we enter into worship today.
Hi, I'm Dustin Maddox, the associate pastor here, and I have a couple of announcements for us this morning. The first is that this last week we began a new small group based on this book, Reunion, The Good News of Jesus for Sinners, Saints, and Skeptics, and there is still time to join. I would love to have you join me on Wednesdays at 7 p.m., and you can find more information on our website at upcfresno.org/online-groups. Second, we are continuing our weekly food distribution, and in order to supplement the food that we are receiving from the Central California Food Bank, you are invited to bring a bag, to fill a pantry bag full of shelf-stable food items and drop it off here at the church campus on Friday mornings from 9 to noon. And you can go to upcfresno.org/food for a list of items that you can fill a brown grocery bag with, and that would provide a huge help to our neighbors who are in need in this season. And finally, we have made up some yard signs for you to put up in front of your homes if you would like. And so next Sunday, June 7th, from 4 to 6 p.m., you can come drive through the church parking lot and see Ren and myself, and we will hand you a yard sign that you can display in your home as people are walking around your neighborhood. It will direct them to be able to watch services like this. So we would love to see you next Sunday, the 7th, from 4 to 6 p.m. here at the church campus. And now let's turn our attention to hearing from God's word today. We have a guest preacher, a friend of ours here at UPC, Simon Biasel, is going to be bringing God's word to us today. So let's open our hearts and minds and spirits as we listen to Jesus' word for you today.
Today's scripture passage is Psalm 12. Help, O Lord, for there is no longer anyone who is godly. The faithful have disappeared from humankind. They utter lies to each other. With flattering lips and a double heart they speak. May the Lord cut off all flattering lips, the tongue that makes great boasts, those who say, with our tongues we will prevail. Our lips are our own. Who is our master? Because the poor are despoiled, because the needy groan, I will rise up, says the Lord. I will place them in the safety for which they long. The promises of the Lord are promises that are pure, silver refined in a furnace on the ground, purified seven times. You, O Lord, will protect us. You will guard us from this generation forever. On every side the wicked prowl as vileness is exalted among humankind. For the word of God in scripture, for the word of God within us, and for the word of God amongst us, thanks be to God. When Ren came to me with this opportunity to preach on this series on the Psalms, she gave me a list of different psalm genres that I could choose from. And those genres included ones that I recognized, like psalm of praise or psalm of joy, psalm of lament. But as I read through, there was one that I didn't quite recognize, and I don't know if I'd ever heard before, the psalm of anger. But once I started reading through some of those psalms of anger, I thought, oh no, I recognize these. I recognize them because pretty much every day since shelter in place, my two kids, 6 years old and 9 years old, have pretty much been reciting these psalms daily. It usually goes something like this. Two kids are screaming back and forth, and then one starts crying. And that one who cries comes to me, gets in my face, and says something like, I've had it with my sister. She's ripping my head off. You need to do something about it. I think you need to start spanking her. Psalm of anger, where somebody has had wrong done against them. Someone has been hurt. Somebody has been oppressed. Someone is surrounded by evil, someone who lies continue to be told about, and they come to God and they want God to do something about it. And ultimately, these are not just psalms of anger, but they're psalms of vengeance. Psalms of people coming and tattletaling. And like tattletaling, we kind of have this negative connotation about vengeance, especially for us Christians who are told by Jesus to turn the other cheek. In fact, C.S. Lewis says about Psalms of vengeance that Christians should avoid them because Christians shouldn't have thoughts of violence or thoughts of vengeance. Well, that's great if you're C.S. Lewis. But for the rest of us, what are we supposed to do with these thoughts of vengeance that we do have? One way is by going and acting out those thoughts of vengeance. That when somebody has harmed us, we go back and do something that make them regret harming us. And maybe you've sought out vengeance. Maybe you are somebody who is prone to seek out vengeance. However, we know that at the end of vengeance is not resolution. That maybe before we act out vengeance, we think that it will fulfill us and that it will make things right. But in reality, at the end, it doesn't make things right. And oftentimes, it just makes things worse. And so what are we supposed to do when we have these thoughts of vengeance? I don't think just suppress them. That doesn't end up well either. Usually we take out vengeance that we intended for somebody else on somebody who had that had nothing to do with whatever we are angry about. And so that's why I think these Psalms of vengeance are actually quite valuable and important and useful. So much so that it has reshaped my thinking about my kids coming and telling on their sibling. Because what I realize they're doing is, one, they're asking for my help. Things have gotten out of hand and they need help. But on top of that, instead of doing harm for harm, instead of seeking vengeance on their sibling, they do the opposite. And they probably do the opposite because they realize that if they do repay harm for harm, that things will not be good. That the screaming and crying will get out of hand, and mom or dad will come in, and everyone will be in trouble. That the consequences of vengeance are not worth it. And so my kids realize that it's better off that they come and tell me. And I'll be honest, usually what I do is borderline shame them. I call them tattletales and tell them to deal with it on their own. But really, they're doing the right thing. They're coming and they're calling out. They're doing these, acting out these Psalms of vengeance. See, when we go out and we act in vengeance, what we're doing is we are going back to the place where evil happened. We go back to the place where wrong happened. We go back to the people who did wrong. And instead of making things right, we end up ensnaring ourselves in that which is wrong. We go back to the place where sin happens, and we end up getting wrapped up in sin. And so we need to avoid that. Now, before we go any further, I want to talk about the difference between vengeance, seeking vengeance, and seeking protection. Seeking vengeance is offensive. That after something has happened, we go back and try and make things right. But seeking protection is defensive. In the moment, we are doing whatever we can to stop the hurt, or minimize the hurt, or prevent the hurt, or get us away from the hurt. And seeking protection is really what a Psalm of vengeance is all about. Instead of going back to the perpetrator, we are going the opposite way, towards God. Instead of us going to, in this psalm, mouths filled with lies, we are going to a God filled with promises that are pure. And when we go and we act out these psalms of vengeance, and we pray these psalms, what we're doing is that we are praying that God would show up in ways that I believe are miraculous. I believe that God has the power to transform people's lives from doing wrong to doing right, transform people's lives of evil to lives of righteousness. But as we're praying for that miraculous thing to happen, something psychological happens to us at the same time. And we see it in this psalm. At the beginning of this psalm, the person wants violence and pain to come down and rain heavy upon this person who hurt them. They want God to cut off lips, and while he's at it, cut off a tongue. But that tone changes at the end of the psalm. They're no longer seeking violence. What they're ultimately seeking is protection. And when we are filled with rage, yes, there are times, admittedly, that we want acts of violence to come down upon others who've hurt us. And we are full of anger. But at the root of that anger, we know, is our fear. And that fear is driving our anger to think that if we don't stop them, if we don't teach them a lesson, we are going to be in danger again. But here's the reality. That's not going to make things better, and it won't necessarily make us safer. However, God is the one who can make us safer. God's pure promise is that when we cry out, that we will receive the safety that we deserve. That this is who God is. And so instead of going back to that place where only harm is done, both to them and to us, we go the opposite direction. We go away from them and we go to God. And in God, God's promises are fulfilled and we are made safe. Amen.
One way that we are the church is not simply the fact that we gather in a physical building, but wherever we go and however we live our lives, we are providing a witness to the reality of God's protection and provision in our lives and for the sake of the world. And one way that we can do that in this season of economic uncertainty is by trusting our financial resources back to God. Through this tangible act of surrendering our resources, we reorder our lives and our loves around God and God's provision for us in our lives. It gives us a greater opportunity to recognize the way that God is active in and through us for the sake of caring for our neighbors and the world. And so you can give today at upcfresno.org/give. You can give online that way, or you can send in a check to the church office and we will take care of that for you here. But as you consider the ways in which God may be inviting you into greater levels of trust and generosity, we have a special treat for us musically today. Our friends in the Lutheran Church have put together a beautiful and moving virtual choir today for Pentecost. So I invite you to engage in a spirit of worship and wonder as we listen to this beautiful hymn for Pentecost.
Oh,
As we turn now to God in prayer, we wanted to take a minute to pastorally address the profound grief and anger and pain that has surfaced in our country over the last few months, but in particular this week with the death of George Floyd in Minneapolis. And with the Psalms as our guide, we want to step into this pain, this anger, and this sorrow and lament the reality that our black and brown brothers and sisters are systematically losing their lives in this country. And we are not taking a stand on the left or the right, but we are standing in line with Jesus and the kingdom. And as I've been seeing the news and processing this week, the words of Dr. King have just echoed in my mind and in my heart that the greatest impediment, he writes in his letter from a Birmingham jail, to the march towards freedom for racial minorities is not the Ku Klux Klan, but is white moderates who are more concerned with protecting and promoting order than they are for promoting justice. And I, as one of your pastors, confess my own complicity and ignorance and privilege that walls me off from the profound injustices that people in our own city and throughout our country experience on a daily, minute-by-minute basis. And so with the hope of the New Jerusalem, where the Tree of Life will heal the divisions between the nations, we call on the name of Jesus to bring that healing into the present moment. And so I invite you to join me in prayer as we lift up the cries of our brothers and sisters and our hearts to God. So let's pray together. Gracious and ever-present God, on this Pentecost day, when you breathed your breath of life upon your people and birthed the church, we are very aware of the breath that has been taken from our black and brown brothers and sisters in this country. And our hearts are filled with sorrow, our bodies are filled with rage, our minds are filled with doubt and confusion about what it would take for justice to flow like streams, as the prophet Micah says. But God, we, in this moment, we look to the example of our brother Jesus, who participated in the sufferings of the people around him, who willingly set aside the privilege of heaven and all the power and the glory that was his by right. He set it aside by his own choice so that he could participate in our sufferings. And so, God, stir up our hearts to follow the example of Jesus and do the same. Help us to have eyes that see and ears that hear injustices in our city, in our neighborhoods, and throughout this country. Help us, with those of us with more privilege than we know what to do with, be able to listen to the stories of our brothers and sisters so that we might learn what it's like to walk in their shoes. God, empower us to get to work at understanding our complicity in systemic racism and systemic injustice in our country and in our city. We're those of us who live northeast of highways 99 and 180 have a 20% higher life expectancy than those who live on the southeast side, southwest side of our city. God, we cry out against the ways that walls are built in the very neighborhood where we gather physically as a church that prevent us from joining in the lives of our brothers and sisters. And so, God, we ask that you would empower your church to be ambassadors for your justice, to be advocates for peace and shalom that would restore and renew all things. We pray for all people who are losing sleep, who are afraid to go on runs or go to sleep for what might awaken them in the middle of the night. God, would you, would we become your children by hungering and thirsting for righteousness and justice? May we pursue your kingdom so thoroughly that our lives would be transformed so that we could transform our cities and our world. We pray this all in the name of our brother Jesus, who taught us to pray by saying together, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Now that we have prayed for God's justice, let's get to work at carrying it out in our world. Amen.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sounds, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, boundless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking.
Thank you. Thank you so much for worshiping with us here at University Presbyterian Church. And especially if you are a guest with us, just a reminder that we would love to know how to best encourage and equip you to be a blessing to those around you. So if you could fill out a connection card at upcfresno.org/connect, we would love to support you in any way. And as you go into the world as witnesses to the love of God in Jesus, may you go with the flame of love burning deep within you. May it make you a light that shines brightly in the world, especially in the face of so much darkness and despair. And may the love of God provide a lamp to your feet wherever you may go. Grace and peace.